Now, tonight, for the first time ever, the Pope will hold a historic meeting with the leader of the Russian Orthodox Church. The meeting in Cuba will be the very first papal meeting with the spiritual head of Russian Orthodoxy since their churches split in the 11th century, mainly over the issue of papal authority. The significance for both churches is immense, and may finally mean that they're edging towards a warmer phase in relations. Our religious affairs correspondent Caroline White reports.
St. Elijah's Monastery near Mosul.
Missions are killed when the church are destroyed. So it's very close to us, and we need to show our concern to all the world. We believe.
At our point, those churches say that the time is now right for them to do more and work together. Christians who have been persecuted across the Middle East. But is the Russian President Vladimir Putin trying to win over Pope Francis as an international ally at a time that Moscow has precious few?
Vladimir Putin is isolated on the world stage and he's looking for a diplomatic triumph of some kind. He's been to see the Pope twice, the Pope's been warm with him, and now Kirill wouldn't be doing this without permission of Putin. So it's a sign of change on the church front over 1,000 years, but change on the international relations front in a more immediate sense.
The coroner has said a newborn baby who died after contracting sepsis did so after a sequence of failures in the healthcare he received during the first 24 hours of his life. Charlie German, who was just 30 hours old, died last May in Cornwall. Our correspondent Duncan Kennedy is outside the coroner's court in Truro for a snap. Duncan.
It's angry and let down. Those are the words used by Charlie's parents this lunchtime. That's Hayley and Mark at the end of this inquest. The coroner said she didn't want to blame individuals in this case. Instead, she said it was the whole healthcare system that had let him down. She said that had he been taken to hospital and given antibiotics for his sepsis, then he would probably still be alive. He was just 30 hours old. Charlie German, unable to fight off the raging sepsis infection inside his body.
I just sit and think, why
the hell did it happen? For his mum and dad, Henry and Mark, all that's left are a box of memories and the deep sense that hospital staff could have done more to save her.
I was kind of let down and really angry.
But, well, just the care wasn't there. And you think you're going to get the answers and experts are going to do what's right.
It was in May last year that Charlie was born into the toilet of the family bathroom during an unplanned home birth. Dr. James Gray, an infection specialist, told the inquest the toilet was an unlikely source of the sepsis, but said if Charlie's symptoms of grunting had been picked up, he would probably have survived. Joanna Bennett, here in the red coat, was one of the midwives involved. She thought the grunting was a sign Charlie was hungry. Another midwife also didn't realise the extent of his illness. 6 months before Charlie died, this one-year-old boy, William Mead, also lost his fight against sepsis infection. Last month, his mother was given an apology by the health secretary, who said the NHS had failed her. But she says lessons still haven't been learned.
Well, I'm absolutely shocked, and I was shocked when I heard from Hayley about what happened to Charlie, and then to hear that it's another case of misdiagnosis of sepsis so close to home. This absolutely proves that we need a public health campaign awareness for sepsis, and this needs to be mirrored throughout our health professionals.
35,000 people a year die from sepsis, which causes massive organ failure. That's more than from lung cancer. Charlie German's mum and dad owe his few short hours on earth. For the shortcomings of his care. Charlie's parents, Mark and Hayley, will now be writing to the Secretary of State, Jeremy Hunt, to ask him once again to tighten up NHS guidelines when it comes to this devastating illness, the sepsis.
Duncan, thank you. The Independent newspaper has announced that it'll stop printing its print editions at the end of March, but it will continue online. It's the first national paper to become digital only. Well, with me now is our media correspondent, David Sillitoe. And David, it's a sad day for print journalism, but a sign of the times.
Very much so. This is a moment that many people have been long expecting. Look at sales. The Independent in its peak, well, early 90s, 428,000 copies a day. If you look into the figures today, The average weekday sales in newsagents and takeaway subscriptions and bulk sales is around 28,000. If you go for that kind of decline, you realise what the business model is. You can no longer hold principles, no longer make money. So they are going to become a digital-only product. The cut price sister paper is already being sold to the Johnston Press. But a wake-up call to the rest of the newspaper industry that has long been looking at sort of 7-8% declines in print sales year after year after year. They had to cut back and cut back. So it's a tough time to make money out of print journalism.
Okay, David, many thanks. A 22-year-old man has pleaded guilty to conspiracy to murder and preparation of terrorist acts. Tariq Hassan from West London was charged over an alleged plot to kill soldiers, police officers and civilians in a series of drive-by shootings on a moped. He's now admitted sourcing a weapon and ammunition in 2014. The prosecution had said he was inspired by the self-styled Islamic State. An inquest has heard that a the bubbly soldier who died at an army base had another side to her that only her friends saw. Cheryl James was aged 18 when she was found with a single gunshot wound to her head at Deep Cut Barracks in 1995. Well, our Home Affairs correspondent June Kelly is at the inquest and working for us now. And June, what more was said about Cheryl James?
Well, Rita, this witness, Helen Miller, was one of Cheryl's closest friends at Deep Cut Barracks. She gave evidence by video link from South Africa. And she was one of the last people to see Private James alive. She said on that November morning, Cheryl James set off for guard duty, seemed to be fine. They said they'd see each other at lunchtime. Helen Miller said then she was told that a gun had gone off, and she said, not for a moment did I think it was Cheryl's rifle that had been fired. She said, I never imagined that she would have taken her own life. She did say that Cheryl James wanted to leave the army. She said, I don't think she cared about the army, and she felt that the army didn't care about her. And she also said that Cheryl James had confided in her that she wasn't happy at home. She said that she saw herself as the black sheep of the family, and she had claimed to Helen Miller that her family blamed her for the death of her cousin a few years earlier. The inquest already heard that he took his own life. Now, this afternoon, the focus of this inquest will switch in that we have now heard a lot of evidence from Cheryl's friends, and this afternoon we will begin hearing from police witnesses. Rita.
Thank you, June. June Kelly there. Unfair and disruptive, that's how teaching unions describe the testing of children in England as they start primary school. Assessments for 4- and 5-year-olds are already being piloted at some schools, and they're expected to be adopted more widely from September. The NUT and ATL unions are critical, but ministers say there has to be a baseline from which to measure pupils' progress. Our education correspondent Mark Ashdown reports.
Good sounding out, very good, turn it over.
Reading, maths and pictures, just a few of the things 4-year-olds will be tested on in their very first days of school life. From September, every school in England will be expected to run baseline assessments.
The government believes that by testing this early, they can better track children's progress over the coming years. And teachers can identify those who might need a bit more help.
But teaching unions warn the tests are disruptive and unreliable. There are 3 different providers, so no way of properly comparing results. They claim they put too much pressure on children when they should just be settling in.
It's unfair, it's not accurate, it's completely fallible. This set of results is a house built on sand, and the government really should reconsider.
Parents here in Ealing are more positive.
I think it's really good, actually. I think the earlier the school can intervene, the better for the child, really. I think if they are going to take it and do something for the children or help the teachers in the classroom with it, then that would be brilliant.
Wales already has baseline testing. Scotland is reintroducing national tests in primary schools. Ministers in England say they don't want to over-test children.